with a lot of scriptures. And this teaching is for our own good and our own benefit, to help us get out of the crisis that we find ourselves in. How many of you were here last week, Sunday, first service, and you were blessed by the teaching? Amen. And you expect God to take you deeper today. I'm not going to go back to everything that I started in the past 2 weeks, but I want to begin from where I ended, and that is Malachi chapter 3, a very familiar passage in the Bible amongst Christians. This passage is so familiar that even those who do not believe in tithe know it very well, and those who believe in tithing knows it very well, but it's very hard for them to practice it. Malachi chapter 3 and beginning from verse 6, God says, "For I am the Lord, I change not. Therefore, you sons of Jacob, I am not consumed." Amen. "Even from the days of your fathers, ye are gone away from my ordinances and have not kept them. Return unto me, and I will return unto you, saith the Lord of hosts. But ye said, wherein shall we return?" Man, ask God a question. How can we return to you after God said, "Return to me"? You have gone away from my ordinances. Then God asks a question. Will a man rob God? And all of them felt like it's impossible. Nobody can rob God. But God answered himself. He said, "Yes, you have robbed me. But ye say, wherein have we robbed thee?" And God answered, "In tithe and in offerings." Look in the face of your neighbor and ask them, "Where have we robbed God?" And answer them in tithe and in offerings. Look at another person again and ask them, "Where have we robbed God?" And give them the answer.
In tithe and offerings.
And then ask your neighbor, "Are you a robber?"
Are you a robber?
See, I don't want the answer from you because I know it. You know, every time I go deep into the studies of this topic, because every time I'm ministering on this, I go back to the Word of God, and God still puts some deep things in my heart. And I always wonder, why is it that the place that so many blessed people should gather, a lot of people that are there are cursed, which is the church? Sometimes I wonder where many good people should be, and then when evaluation is done, you realize that there are more criminals than good people. The church should not be the place to find more robbers. But in these days, we find many robbers in the church. Some of them can sing very well. Some of them can preach very well. And some of them can usher very well. Some of them can play instrument very well. Some of them can do video recording very well. Some of them control the equipment very well. And some of them can wipe the church very well, but they are robbers. And imagine God asks, God said, "I know you are asking me, where have we robbed you?" God said, "Let me answer you, in tithe and in offering." And I believe strongly anyone that repents of this and is not a robber, God said, is the means of returning to him for him to return to you. You become a very close friend of God. And I read everywhere in the Bible and I find out where God says he comes to you and you come to him is when you are a faithful tither and offering giver. Not to any other thing. Amen.
Amen.
Now let's look at verse 9. He said, you are cursed with a curse. For you have robbed me, even this whole nation. Even nations are robbing God. He said, you have robbed me, so you are cursed with a curse. Imagine God telling you that you are cursed. Now, if anybody else curses you, it takes God to remove that curse. But if God himself places a curse on you, who can help you remove it? No matter how anointed your bishop can be, he cannot remove that curse. That is why some of you have gone through 69 different sessions of deliverance. And you are still financially stranded. Because what makes you to be in that deplorable financial condition is the curse that you are under from God. And you are there explaining a whole lot of stories. And this one, and that one, and this one, and that one. Pastor, I have tried, but the conditions stay the same. I have to beg before I eat. And that is not the will of God for you. So today, God is telling you the secret. The reason why you keep struggling. The reason why you are a beggar. David said, I was young, and now I am. But what is it that he has not seen yet? He has never seen the righteous begging for bread. He has never seen the seed of the righteous begging for bread. And today, it is not the same with us. The mean beggars are the righteous. That's the truth. In fact, the righteous run people from church. That is why most of the churches, the good people don't like to come to church always. Because every time they come, they meet little. Those that can afford a little bit when they come to church, every Sunday, even if they don't come, 3 Sundays in a month, the 4th Sunday when they come, they will meet little. Something a small note will cross from the other end to the other end. Please, thank God you came today. Because I don't even know how we manage tomorrow. 2 weeks now my son been out of school fee. That righteous rating I cannot better. When David said he had not seen it. I don't know how David managed to make me see that. Wow. Father, I pray that we stop seeing what David didn't see. What David didn't see is what I am seeing. Even all over, from Genesis to Revelation, everybody can bring something to the priest. But after Revelation, in our time, everybody wants to get something from the priest. That's how you can know that curse is dominating. Sometimes I get afraid to come to work. As those that I get afraid to come to work. Because if you come to work and you think you come and counsel people and pray for healing and pray for deliverance, those that come for school fees and help more than those who come for prayer. So I can be wondering whether my office, that NGO or that gospel office. Because there is a curse. It's not unbelievers, it's the righteous. And then they say, I've never seen. I was young. Even when I was there with my father Jesse, I didn't see the righteous or their seed begging for bread. When I was a child, we didn't beg for bread. In fact, fact, when I was a little boy, there were times that my father, when he sent me to go and see my brothers at the battlefront, he would give me something to carry for the king. We're not rich, but we're not beggars. When the king sent message to my father that I heard that you have a son in your house who can play the instruments for demons to leave me, he was going to do deliverance for the king, but he still carried bread. How many persons do we have in the church that can go to the king and not ask for something but carry something? We have spoiled the scripture because we are under curse. It is not a good thing for the righteous seed to be begging. At least for the Muslim people, their beggars came into the door. But for us, our beggars will wear the same suits and they sit right beside us. In the Old Testament, the beggars never used to enter the church. They sat at the gate of beautiful. But in our modern testament, because in the New Testament, the guy was at the gate. But in our modern testament, the beggar can sit on the same seat with you. And do you know that everybody that enters the temple has the potential to give somebody at the gate of the temple? But today, everybody that enters the temple, they are there to receive because of the curse. Am I talking to some people today?
Yes.
Is there anybody who wants to graduate from that level?
Yes.
He said, you are cursed with a curse, even your whole nation. And when God curses you, nobody can change it. So verse 10, he said, this is the solution. Can we read the solution together? What the solution is? For you not to be under curse, everybody together, bring ye all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be meat in my house, and prove me now, herewith saith the Lord of hosts, if I will not open you the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing, that there shall not be room enough to receive it. So what is the solution for people to cease in the church? What is the solution? Don't say bring the tithe, we'll say all. Because some of you have been praying this song. The way for the entire congregation, the entire church, to be free from the curse is to bring all the tithe. Somebody say all the tithe.
All the tithe.
And all the offering.
And all the offering.
You got to bring it in the church. Now look at verse 11. Verse 11 can stop you from doing all night because of poverty. He says, and I will rebuke the devourer for your sakes, and he shall not destroy the fruits of your ground, neither shall your vine cast for fruit before the time in the field, saith the Lord of hosts. Now you see one thing here, I think I'll just play with scriptures today. You see one thing here? The Bible says that God says he, God, will do what? Will rebuke the devourer. Now, you know the reason why you are doing all the rebuking and doing all the warfare? For your business not to break down. For your crops to grow. You're doing all the spiritual warfare. Listen, there are some warfare you are not even supposed to do. But because you are not faithful in paying your tithe and offering, you are doing what God should be doing for you. And you can't do it better than God. You can't. Nobody can fight your enemies better than God. God wants to fight your enemies. He wants to deal with the devourers for your sake. But the only way God can do it, except you bring all the tithe and the offering. And when you bring all the tithe and the offering, he's going to open the windows of heaven to pour out blessing. So people are not experiencing open windows and open heavens because their hands are too tight when they're tithe. Wow. tithe on your tithe. Imagine when you go to verses 14 downwards in Malachi chapter 3, for the sake of time, I want to switch to another chapter. Imagine, you see that God said, when the people, imagine Christians. No, let's go there. This will help you. Let's go there. Verse 14. Look at verse 14. He said, you have what? It is what? Vain to serve God. You know how many Christians say, we are serving God. We were serving God. Nothing happening for us. Then the people that are in the world, they are the ones that enjoy and we are suffering. You are not the first person to say it. There were a group of people saying it too. There were a group of people saying it. And what were they saying? He said, you have said it in his vain. Man, serving God, man. They're serving God. They're serving God. People still suffering. How many years now? You have said it is vain to serve God. And what profit is it? That we have kept his ordinance. We keep him all the Lord. I can't even fornicate. I can't even drink. And not even profiting me. All the other people are getting high, they're getting flipped. They're not even doing it, they're not profiting me. We have kept his ordinance. And that we have walked moonfully. I took part in the fast and prayer, my whole life looking sorrowful before the Lord of hosts. And now we call the proud happy. The people that are not fasting, they are happy. Yea, they work wickedness and are set up. Yea, they that tempt God are even to labor. And they that fear the Lord speak often one to another. And what? And the Lord hearkened and heard it. So those that fear God and were speaking, and God listened and God heard it. And what did God do? Everybody help me. What did God do? What did God do? He opened a book of remembrance that was written before him for them that fear the Lord and that thought upon his name. Those that fear him and thought upon his name. God opened a book of remembrance. And the book of remembrance are the tithe book. God opened the tithe book to see all those that are faithful in paying tithe. You're not paying tithe, then you're complaining about hardship. For what? We just serving God for nothing. It's a vain thing to serve God. And I walk even under the rain. I walk even under the sun. The simple thing, you're not doing it. You are not doing it. You are not doing it. The windows of heaven, when they are open, so much blessings can come. Not just as money, but blessings can come with so many things. I always tell people, you are not a true child of God if you pay for everything you own. I'm telling the truth. If you pay for everything, anybody say, Bishop, who said it? And I will prove it. You are not a true child of God if you pay for everything you own in life. Because if God opens the windows of heaven, all kinds of things will pour out for you. You think why I can boast that I have money in everybody's account? Because the window is open. So any account can produce for you. Amen. Whether you like it or not, I got money in your account.
Amen. Amen.
Are you hearing me?
Amen.
You see the blue vein out there, I never asked for it. I never wrote any letter for it. I didn't add another man of God when he said, okay, he said, God speaking to me that you should give me now your car. I don't do that. I was far off when they called me and said, son, we have a vineyard and we think you will like it. Come and see it. And before I saw you, I said, I like it. He said, but you're not seeing it, I said, in the spirit. The Lord used me to minister to a lady who was going to commit suicide in Texas. And I didn't know Texas at that time. But you see, God will cause things to happen for you when you are faithful in tithing and offering. It was my first time in Texas in 2008, in Houston. And this man came crying where I was stopping. Like the wife has left the house and she went to commit suicide. The whole day he has not seen his wife until the next day. And you know what happened? I told him, I said, I can find home. He started playing for him. He said, but you don't even know this place. Where will you find home? He said, it's all going to one village. And I told my host, let's get in your car and drive around. But when they are taking me, I'm looking for a village. I can't see village. Because their village is not our village. And I was expecting to see real village. But to make the story short, we walked and we drove around. And I've never seen a lady before. I didn't even see her picture. But God made me to find a woman.
Amen.
And I got down from the car, walked to her, and said, I'm looking for you. She said, me? I said, yes, you. She said, well, okay, do you know me? I said, I don't know you, but God knows you. So I talked to the woman, told the woman home. I called the husband, and the husband said to me, I thought you said you were a pastor. I said, yeah, I'm a pastor. He said, why am I in pain and playing fun out of me? I said, I have your wife. But don't come here today. Come to God. Let me counsel her. And finally, when he came and we're taking her home, while we're driving into their compound, they had a big expedition jeep parking. And she said, Pastor, you like that jeep? I said, I don't laugh. I said, well, we should open it. Let me try it. I don't let people ask me whether you like beauty. If I even see it, I like it. But because I had a Land Cruiser, so I gave it up for offering to somebody else. Now, what am I saying? When you are faithful in tithe and offering, listen to me. I don't cajole people. As a financial man, I'm the pastor of this church. I believe many pastors believe they should be at the receiving end. But one of my desires and one thing I purpose is that I don't like for people to beat me. In giving. Amen. In this church. I don't like to put a big thing in giving. If I'm not the highest giver in any given year, I should be one of the highest givers. As much as I'm the pastor. If I decide to take record of the money I spend, sometimes my leaders around me say can be advising me and counseling me. If I decide to take record. Even if I decide to take the money that belongs to me from the church account, the church will be broke. So I'm not a devil say because you want money from people. No. No. Because of these simple principles, God has greatly blessed me.
Amen.
Not anything much. It's not because of the way I speak in tongues. It's not because I do all night prayers. No. But just simply obey. Now open your Bible to Genesis chapter 28. Let me just take you through some nuggets. Genesis chapter 28. Let me just run through some things for you to see. Verse 15 is one of the powerful scriptures I've ever seen in the Bible. Genesis 28, 15. And it reads, and behold, I am with thee, and will keep thee. Are you there? 28, 15, 15. And behold, I am with thee, and will keep thee in all places whither thou goest. And will bring thee again into this land. For I will not leave you until I have done that which I have spoken to thee of. Wow. Tell your neighbor, that's too powerful.
That's too powerful.
It's one of the most powerful scriptures I've seen in the Bible. That God says that he will bring me back to the place of glory. He will be with me wherever I go. And he will not leave me until he performs the things he has spoken. And do you know how many good things God has spoken that he wants to perform? Wow. Woo! And Jacob awaked, verse 16, out of his sleep. And he said, surely the Lord is in this place. How many of you know that God is in this place? When the choir sing, you know, the priest, the minister, you know, people preach, you know that God is here. Tell your neighbor, God is in this place. And Jacob said, surely the Lord is in this place, and I knew it not. And he was afraid and said, how dreadful is this place? This is none other but the house of God, and this is the gate of heaven. Tell your neighbor, this is the gate of heaven. This is the gate of heaven. And Jacob rose up early in the morning and took the stones that he had put for his pillows and set them up for a pillar and poured oil upon the top of it. And he called the name of that place Bethel. But the name of that city was Luz at the first. And Jacob vowed and vowed. Look at verse 20. And Jacob did what? Saying, if God will be with me and will keep me in this way that I go, and will give me bread to eat and clothes to wear, so that I come again to my father's house in peace, then shall the Lord be my God. And this stone which I have set for a pillar shall be God's house, and of all that thou shalt give me, I will surely give thee. Passage. Jacob had not experienced the reality. What Jacob had was a dream, a revelation. And as a result of the revelation, Jacob brought himself to the place of making a vow. Jacob had a vision, he had a dream. He had a revelation when he saw that the ladder was set from the earth to the heavens and the angels were ascending and descending. It was what Jacob saw in a revelation. He said, wow, this is the house of God. He took his pillows, turned them to pillars, anointed them, and said, God, I'm making a vow to you today. If you carry me where I'm going and you feed me and get me close to where, and bless me to come back to my father's house. God, I can assure you, everything that you gave me, I will give you a tenth of it, which is a tithe. And because of that, God carried that tricky boy, sustained him in Laban's house, protected him, gave him wisdom, blessing, brought him back, only because he made a vow to pay the tithe. Jacob went to Laban's house as an individual, and God brought him out as a nation. Amen. He went as individual and came back with 12 tribes. He came back with surplus. And Jacob fulfilled his vow. If you look at that passage very well, hasn't God taken you out when you go to your job? Who carries you on your way? Does he bring you back to your house? Does he feed you? Does he clothe you? Then where is your tenth? God, if you take me on my way successfully, and you bring me back successfully, you bless me, you make me to eat and dress, God, I will give you. Imagine God does all that for you, but rather you take the tithe and put it in one Indian woman hair. ago, we went to Full Gospel Women Fellowship and they put in a car. And they put the car on the tow truck. They were making a lot of arguments, so we decided to take it to the office. They carried the car. When I went there, they quoted all their loans and everything. You have to pay $100 and all that thing. After everything they took, the moment I gave them the $50, Priscilla was there. Somebody came with hair and they took her $25 and paid for hair. I'm not even talking about what they gave to the government, but they bought $25 here. Do you think they want to take us something from God for going here? And before them and said came down to 50, what were they discussing about their churches? One in Bethel, one in First Baptist. And yet, two of them received $50 in the office. And the first thing, one person didn't buy here with $25, let me go finish. Genesis chapter 2. Let's look at two verses, verses 16 and 17. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden, thou mayest freely what? But of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, thou shalt not eat of it. For in the day that thou eatest thereof, what will happen to you? See how wicked we are. God planted whole garden. Now watch this. He didn't even allow Adam to be the planting. God himself came down from heaven and planted garden according to Genesis 2:8. And the Lord God planted a garden, each one in Eden. God himself planted a garden. He made a choice of the kind of fruits to put in the garden, the kind of trees to put there. He planted the garden himself. And after God planted the garden, he put Adam there. Adam made everything there. He and wife Eve. Then God now commanded them in verse 16. Verses 16 and 17. And God said, now, all the trees are put in the garden here. They are for you to eat, except this one in the middle. Don't touch it. And do you know that we don't even have record whether they ate of the other one? But the one that in the middle was what they chopped. And God said, if you eat it, you will die. They are not even finished eating the other ones. But they went straight to the one that they were not supposed to eat. And if you eat it, what will happen to you? If you eat it, what will happen to you? And look at that. That was the tithe. Everything for you, but don't eat my tithe. And they ate the tithe. And they ate the tithe. Now, do you know how many persons are dead living? You are looking like you are alive, but you are a walking dead. When Adam and Eve died, were they not walking around? They were still walking, but they were dead. They were complaining, but they were dead. So many believers that you see that they are complaining and complaining and complaining, they are walking dead. There is no one that I've ever known that is faithful in time that is a good complainer. No. They were not complaining. They drank too hard. Look at my palm. Look at this. Why they were in a life before, when they were faithful not to touch the tithe, they couldn't search for gold. The Bible says, and the river searched for the gold. They were not strong. You see, every time you decide to eat tithe, you decide to put yourself into struggle. And you know what I like about it in Genesis chapter 3? In Genesis chapter 3, the Bible says that after they ate the fruit, what happened to them? their eyes open, what happened to them? And when their eyes open, what did they see? What did they see? You see, their eyes are not open for good. They open to realize that because we ate this food, we are naked. Every time you eat your tithe, you naked yourself. Every time you eat your tithe, you uncover yourself of the glory. You uncover yourself. Every time you eat tithe, you kill yourself financially. You kill yourself from wealth. You kill yourself from prosperity. Because when the devourer comes, you don't have anybody to fight for you. You know what the devil did? He always suggests it. He always wants you to eat what God doesn't want you to eat. And I still want to make clear here before I go to my final scripture for today. I still want to make clear here. You know what I want to make clear? Tithe is never yours. Tithe is not giving. Tithe is not giving. Tithe belongs to God. It belongs to God. You cannot give me something that already belongs to me. Tithe is an obligation. It's not giving. You are obliged to pay your tithe. Every time you are blessed with a garden, there are trees that you're not supposed to eat from. It's not giving. Tithe is God's portion in whatever He blesses you with. Can we say that together? Tithe is what? God's portion in whatever He blesses me with. Tithe is God's portion in whatever He blesses me with. So every time God blesses you, there is a portion for Him in that blessing. And when you go ahead to eat His portion, you are ingrate. You are ungrateful. Because Jacob said, Lord, when you take me on my way and you feed me, you dress me, and you bring me back, I will give you your portion. So it means that he has taken you on your way. You are very ungrateful to the man that took you on your way. Very ungrateful to the man that fed you. Very ungrateful to the man that dressed you. Very ungrateful to the man that made you to reach home safely when others die in accident on your way home. And you stay in his time. Ingrates, bunch of ingrates. Say that in church, let me lift you up, holy hands. I don't know how holy your hand is, the hand that stole God's money. And their eyes were open, not to see good things, but to see that they were naked. Because when you eat tithe, what can happen? Finally, in Genesis chapter 14. I will read quick and just pick one point because my time for first service is one more. Somebody tell your neighbor, say this thing is serious. Tell another person the same thing, this thing is serious. Genesis chapter 14, and I begin from verse 14. And when Abram heard that his brother was taken captive, he armed his trained servants, bought in his own house 318, and pursued them unto them. And he divided himself against them, he and his servants by night, and smote them, and pursued them into Hobah, which is on the left hand of Damascus. And he brought back all the goods, and also brought again his brother Lot and his goods, and the women, also the people, and the people. And the king of Sodom went out to meet him after his return from the slaughter of Chedorlaomer, and of the kings that were with him, at the valley of Sheber, which is the king's thereof. Now watch this. Abraham took his army, his private army. They went and fought those who went and invaded Sodom and took a lot of people and things out of Lot into their country. Abraham carried an army and retrieved them. And now Abraham returned from the war in verse 18. And Melchizedek, king of Salem, brought forth bread and wine, communion. And he was the priest of the Most High God. And he blessed him and said, blessed be Abraham of the Most High God. Blessed be Abraham of the Most High God, possessor of heaven and earth. Are you with me?
Amen.
And blessed be the Most High God, which hath delivered thy enemies into thy hand. And he gave him what? What did Abraham give him? Tithe of song. Tithe of few. Tithe of most. But tithe of what? And the king of Sodom said, after Abraham gave tithe, when the high priest blessed him, then the king of Sodom, whom Abraham fought for, now said to Abraham, get me the persons and take the goods to thyself. Get me the people you capture and take all the goods for yourself. And listen to Abraham. This is what I'm like. And Abraham said to the king of Sodom, I have lifted up my hands unto the Lord, the Most High God, the possessor of heaven and earth. Did you hear that? Eh? So that I will not take from a thread, even a shoe lashed, and that I will not take anything that is thine, lest thou should have said, I have made Abraham rich. Wow. I know some of you didn't understand that thing. When Abraham came from the battle, he brought a lot of things, goods with him. And Abraham met the high priest. The high priest gave him communion, and Abraham took tithe of all and gave it to the high priest. After he gave the high priest, then the king of Sodom came and said, hey, but Abraham, I want you to just give me the people you capture. You can take everything. Abraham said, you are making a mistake. I have already lifted my hands to the Most High God, the possessor of the heaven and earth. So I can't take anything for you to say you made me rich. I've done the best thing to do already. How did he lift up his hands to the Most High God? By giving his tithe. Right after he gave his tithe, the king wants to believe that he made Abraham rich. When you lift up your hands to the Most High God, you don't need the help of men to make your testimony. I have already. Lifted up my hands to the Most High God. I have already done that. I gave all my tithe. I gave all my tithe. So I don't need you to come and give me stuff. You don't even know how I got to this level. You don't even know how it took me to train my private army. Then you want to give me one. You can't contribute. I've already lifted up my hands. How did he do that? By giving his tithe. So he said, I don't even need prayer from you. I don't need anything. So that tomorrow you cannot say, you made me. I know my maker already is my God. Amen. When you pay your tithe, you purchase land. You purchase territory. Did you hear that? Eh? And when you give your offering, you see, I can get $200 and my tithe. Regular tithe, not me, not because I pay covenant tithe. My covenant tithe is 25%. But regular tithe is 10%. When you pay the 10%, which is $20 from the $200, you are left with $180. So that $20 purchases you a spot. Now the offering you put there determines what you plant there. So if you decide to put small offering, you got big land, but you only put crop in small land. Are you hearing me?
Yeah.
The offering is what you do by your will. is what you determine the tithe. You don't determine it. God is the one that determines what the tithe is. But the offering is you that determine what you want to give. And your level of giving. Have I made Solomon crazy? Solomon said, I've been seeing my father David all about making sacrifices. But for me, I want to change my offering. And he slaughtered 23,000 in one day. Imagine somebody making sacrifice for God and everybody went to the entire. Copy, they come to the other one. He said, chief, retire. He said, go ahead, gentlemen. Chief, we are tired. Go ahead. And God said, yes, sacrifice. He will jump today. And when the ball got through, it was a small ball. When he got through, God left heaven. God who got heaven as his throne and the earth as his footstool, he fitted in Solomon. So Solomon's dream was bigger than heaven and earth combined. You see what your offering can do? Yeah? The kind of offering that Solomon gave made God to bring plenty. Most times God can tell you what he will do for you, but this time he says, Solomon, tell me what you want. Solomon wouldn't even throw the check. He asked for wisdom and good leadership. God said, I think too small. Imagine God himself helped Solomon to fill the check. He said, okay, the one you put there will remain there, but I'm also adding riches that nobody will be as rich as you. Nobody. Even if they were selling golden sheep for $50, times 50 times 23,000 in Solomon's days. Times that. God wants to change you. He said, I am the Lord, I change not. That was the very first scripture we read. He doesn't change. So whatever is happening to you is because of your own attitude. If you come back to him, he will come back to you. Stop cheating yourself and thinking that you are cheating God. Stop stealing from yourself and think that you are stealing from God. If everybody else will be faithful, even at your level, to pay your tithe and your offering, the church doesn't even have to be raising seed to do some things. And then, just look at me, if all of you are paying your tithe regularly, some things the church will want to do, just go ahead and do it. In a year's time, we are all faith, tithe, and offering. We can meet our obligations, and the AC will want to buy. We don't even have to do any program or raise any seed for it. But you cannot make the house of God stranded and your life go smooth. He said, bring it into my storehouse and let there be meat, and you see whether your windows will not open. You cannot. You can't keep the plane at 29,000 feet and you go to 35,000 feet. It's not possible. Where the plane is where you be. So if you want to go higher, you got to take the flight higher. God bless you. Stand to your feet.